Hello friends, welcome to Smart News Digital. Today, let's see the current affairs of 11th September 2018. The articles we'll be seeing today are these 8. Let's see them all in detail now. The first topic we are going to see today is clemency question, the Rajiv Gandhi assassination case. So clemency question is nothing but the mercy petition with respect to the Rajiv Gandhi assassination case. So the TN government has yet again decided to invoke the governor's clemency powers under Article 161 of the Constitution to free the accused who were tried for the Rajiv Gandhi assassination case about 2 decades back. So what is Article 161 of Indian Constitution? That you have to know. And you also have to know how Article 161 varies from Article 72, which deals with the powers of the president. So this Article 161 is with respect to the governor's power to pardon the accused tried under different cases. So this states that the governor of the state shall have power to grant pardons, reprieves, respite or remission of any punishment, or to suspend, remit, commute the sentence of any person who is convicted for an offence which can be executed under the power extended for the state. So this power of the governor under 161, it varies from the Article 72 of President under two distinct ways. Number one is the powers under Article 72 is pretty much wide when compared to Article 161. The power of the president to grant pardon, it even extends to the court martials under Article 72, which is not available to the governor under Article 161. And the second important point is, the president can pardon even death sentences, however, that power is not available to the governor. So earlier in the year 2014, Tamil Nadu government has attempted to remit the same convicts for Rajiv Gandhi assassination case under Code of Criminal Procedure, which was stayed by the Supreme Court. So finally, after a lot of negotiations and arguments, it was held that Centre had the primacy according to remission of life convicts in case of the cases involving consultation between the Centre as well as the state. So here, Rajiv Gandhi assassination case was of national importance, which involves stakes both of Centre as well as the state. So here, in case of such cases, the primacy will be given to the stand taken by the Centre. And the Supreme Court has also cautioned both the Centre as well as the state not to use the clemency powers of the governors as well as the president for political considerations. So here, under the current scenario, the governor of Tamil Nadu, Mr. Banvariya Purohit, he has 3 options under his ambit which he can exercise. Number one is he can act as per the direction given by the State Council of Ministers and decide according to it. Or number two, he can take into consideration the previous views of Supreme Court as well as the center, and he can reject the proposal of the state government, or he can even seek for reconsideration of the same proposal by the state government. And however, one must also remember that any decision taken by the governor is not beyond the ambit of judicial review. And in case of breach of the values enshrined in our constitution, the Supreme Court or the High Court can step in and act accordingly. So this case of Rajiv Gandhi assassination has brought in several other questions into limelight. So for example, 4 of the accused under this Rajiv Gandhi case are from Sri Lanka. So if in case these 4 people are freed, what will happen to them? Will they stay back in India, or will they be sent back to their own country, Sri Lanka? And also, shouldn't there be a case-by-case evaluation for releasing those sentenced for life? Shouldn't their part in the crime be analyzed exclusively before releasing them? All these questions must be addressed on case-by-case basis before granting pardon to them. So on one hand, on humanitarian basis, the idea that convicts who have suffered prolonged stay at the jail, they require to be treated with compassion. And the idea of locking away a person for rest of his life without any freedom of hope is against the true principles enshrined in modern democratic society. And looking at the same case in another angle, it can also be seen that this case brings into notice the issue of capital punishment yet again. For example, releasing persons who are involved in cases like murder and other severe crimes will definitely have an effect on negatively on the society. So in that case, the society may again shift its glare on bringing in capital punishment, which is a retrograde step. So finally, although there are many political considerations behind especially this case, the final verdict must be decided only based on the legal principles and not based on any political manifestations. The second article we'll be seeing today is with respect to the economy part. Cause for caution on India's GDP growth. Recently, India's projected GDP growth stands at around 8.2% for the April-June fiscal, and this 8.2% estimation, it raises some serious concerns. For example, there are issues of depreciating rupee. The rupee crossed the 72 mark against dollar recently, and there's also issues of rising bank bad loans or non-performing assets, that is NPAs, and the issue of rising trade deficit, especially against countries like China, is also on rise. So all these issues added with the recent retail fuel price hike has caused serious concerns to the health of Indian economy. And the rational explanation for this high 8.2% projection is due to the low base effect, as our economy performed in a low level due to last year's structural inefficiencies like demonetization and implementation of GST. So let's see how each structure of our economy performed. Number one is agricultural sector. The agricultural GDP quickened due to the factor of increased rain for past two successive years. And the manufacturing and construction sector, they also performed pretty well. They recovered well from the shocks projected due to demonetization, and they recovered well from the after the implementation of GST also. However, the third important sector, that is service sector, its growth rate slowed. So the industries such as trade, hotels and transport, financial and real estate sector, and other professional services which fall under the service sector ambit, they kind of suffered a slow growth rate this fiscal. So this service sector growth rate is considered to be relatively more representative. This is because the urban and the semi-urban Indians are mostly employed in the service sector, and their economic sentiments are clearly manifested via the service sector growth rate projection. And the performance of the service sector probably explains well the sense of disconnect with the global estimates being expressed in some quarters. So despite the low performance of the service sector when compared to a year ago, this service sector, it still grew better when compared to agricultural GDP in spite of the agricultural GDP performing well this fiscal. However, in spite of high agricultural growth rate, it is pretty much early to predict whether the rural distress has actually ended. The government has brought in many schemes. However, the rural wage growth has remained stagnant for past 5 years. So another important factor which one must need to note in the projection of GDP in our country is the GDP growth in our country, it continues to be dominated by the consumption and not investments. One must also need to know that this consumption-driven economic growth is sustainable only up to a point, and beyond that, it becomes unsustainable. So one must take into consideration the global example for this situation. The global financial crisis was driven by savings and investment. So after the global economic slowdown, which disrupted the trend, the investment famine followed, and this famine, it also struck India. Giving some empirical insights to this situation, the share of investments in GDP dropped from 32.2% in January-March to 31.6% in April-June this year. So this is a direct consequence of worsening NPA crisis in our country. Though bank recapitalization was taken, the situation was not rectified. The insolvency mechanism was also bought in, but it suffers from initial delays even now. Even big-scale scams like Nirav Modi and Vijay Mallya scam, they could not bring the situation back to normalcy. So in order to sustain 8+ growth rate propounded in the first quarter, there needs to be some proactive policy in order to give push to the economic stability. So apart from this year being an election year, other issues like international crude prices to the increasing trade wars between various countries, India must ensure that the current account deficit is under check. So the depreciating value of rupee will lead to inflation, especially with respect to the fuel prices, unless the state and the central government, they cut in the taxes for them. So if at all the central and the state government, they cut in the taxes, that will lead to increasing fiscal deficit of the central and the state government. So for resolving that, the Reserve Bank of India needs to step in and change the interest rate to arrest the rupee depreciation, and this vicious cycle will continue. So in order to maintain the economic health of our country, reforms need to be brought in to remove the fiscal bottlenecks and to promote growth in both short-term and long-term scenarios. So the third article we'll be seeing today is with respect to governance. Delhi launches doorstep delivery of government services. So Delhi government has brought in a new easy way to deliver services to its citizen at their doorstep. So this includes services like driving license, marriage registration, ration cards, birth certificates, water connection, etc. with a very low fee of 50 rupees. So this measure will definitely improve the ease at which the services is delivered to the citizens by the government. However, this issue has several other bottlenecks also. For example, at the day one of implementation, about 21,000 people they attempted to initiate these services. However, out of this 21,000, only 2,700 calls were connected, and finally documents were given only to 7 people. So this shows the serious implementation loopholes in this policy which needs to be corrected in order to benefit the citizens. The fourth issue we'll be seeing today is with respect to World Health Organization. The World Health Organization calls for better preparedness in case of emergencies. So the World Health Organization has called upon countries, especially in South Asia, to strengthen their emergency medical teams in order to be prepared to face public health emergencies. So we all know that Southeast Asian region is vulnerable to disasters and emergencies such as earthquakes, floods, tsunamis, landslides and even volcano eruptions. So according to 2016 World Disaster Report, over the past decade, the Southeast Asian region alone, it accounted for about 26.8% of death, especially during these emergencies. So in order to face this high disproportionately disaster situations and emergencies, Southeast Asian region needs to be prepared with emergency and management team. So if this initiative of WHO, it seeks to improve the timeliness and the quality of health services provided at both national and international emergency response teams. So it seeks to enhance the capacity of national health system, and it also seeks to cooperate between the national and the international system to face the emergency situations. So apart from this emergency initiative, the WHO has also urged the member countries in Southeast Asian region to implement separate national plan for strengthening the emergency management team. So this will be in collaboration with other partners, and it will lead to strengthening of national mechanism to provide a highly effective and high performing national emergency operation in line with the WHO mandated standards. So the fifth article we'll be seeing today is CPEC to consider Pakistan's social sector priorities. So we need to know what CPEC is. CPEC stands for China-Pakistan Economic Corridor, and this CPEC is especially important to national security of India as CPEC passes through Pakistan-occupied Kashmir, which is a part of India. So this CPEC starts from Kashgar in China and it comes all the way down to Gwadar port of Pakistan via Pakistan-occupied Kashmir, which puts the sovereignty of India under threat. And via this project of CPEC, China and Pakistan, they are looking for fresh projects which will lead to socio-economic development of the social infrastructure in Pakistan. The two sides are also planning to enhance. So Pakistan hopes that this CPEC will help to improve its economic development. So via this CPEC, Pakistan hopes that China will help Pakistan to develop its economic development and meet the other priorities and the needs of people living in Pakistan. The sixth article we'll be seeing today is with respect to Kerala. Much must change in Kerala. So we all know that Kerala has been stuck with devastating floods recently. And this article touches upon the disaster preparedness areas with respect to the state of Kerala. So Kerala is definitely a unique state. So not just with respect to India, but also globally. So the society of Kerala has high human development, even with relatively low income. So it has to be pointed out globally that in many societies apart from Kerala, they've especially in east of India, they've achieved the same status with respect to Kerala as of Kerala in case of social indicators like health and education. However, Kerala also has a unique scenario as it suffers from structural inequalities perpetuated due to caste and religion. So this social stratification experienced in Kerala is not present in other East Asian countries. So those countries, they were easily able to transform their social indicators. But in case of Kerala, it has to overcome all these social burdens via non-violent political revolution, which is a considerably high achievement when compared to rest of the states of India. So if one analyzes the society of Kerala, one will notice that natural capital and the associated ecological services have accompanied the rise in income. So it is because of the natural capital and the ecology of Kerala, the state achieved high rise in income. However, this economic development, it led to decline in natural capital in the state. For example, the deforestation has contributed to rainwater runoff, which in turn led to landslides in the state of Kerala. So other than that, sand mining led to rivers overflowing their banks and also floodplains, which was meant to act as cushion from protecting flood-like situation. So all of these have resulted in the flooding which occurred in Kerala recently. So the Madhav Gadkil committee report, which studied the Western Ghats in Kerala and other Kerala's topography and also its alteration. So it has said that it is the human actions which along with unusually high rains has led to the flooding scenario in Kerala. So another important reason in Kerala is high trend in consumption. So in relation to the ecological damage in Kerala, the concept of luxury housing, especially with respect to commercial holiday resorts, it is on very high trend in Kerala. So these high structures, they are ecologically unsustainable and making the ecological system highly unstable, making it prone to other natural disasters. So this irrational use of the scarce resources, especially land, has led to this catastrophic consequences. So on a way forward, it was emphasized in this article that apart from the political role played by the government, it is the role of civil society of Kerala in order to be proactive and take steps to prevent such disastrous scenario in future. Bringing in transparency in functioning of the government machinery and other and proactive role of civil society is very essential for inclusive growth of the state of Kerala. The seventh article we'll be seeing today is with respect to Reserve Bank of India. The Reserve Bank of India intervenes as rupee breaches 72.5 to dollar. So this news of fall of rupee against dollar has been in news for past 1 week, and it has touched the 72.5 rupees as against dollar recently. Various steps have been taken in order to stop this fall of currency, including deposit schemes for non-resident Indians along with the central bank intervention. However, due to these steps, rupees strengthened to 72.18 rupees. However, beyond that, it didn't show any positive results. So for the first time, some verbal intervention by the government to take measures in order to stop the weakening of rupee was also shown here. So apart from India, several other currencies of world economy such as Korea, South Africa and Indonesia, they also are seeing a falling trend recently. The RBI has also taken some proactive steps and it sold some of its dollars from its reserves in order to stop the weakening of Indian rupee. It is to be noted that RBI performed similar operations in the month of June, wherein it sold about $6 billion at the spot market in order to prevent weakening of Indian rupee. Due to these scenarios, rupee is a worst performer among the emerging economies, especially in Asia, as it depreciated about 13% when compared to last financial year. The last topic we'll be seeing today is only 33% of Indians save regularly for retirement, says a report. So this report released by HSBC's title Future of Retirement Bridging the Gap, it says that only a third of Indians, they regularly save, while just 33% of the working age people globally, they put anything aside for later of their lives. So this lack of saving can be attributed to two main factors. Number one is low knowledge on how much money to be needed after retirement, as well as many people, they don't know how to prioritize their financial situation towards planning their older years. The report also added that over half of working age people, that is 56%, are still living on day-to-day basis financially, while further 53% of them, they only save for their short-term goals. Most of the working age people, they are looking forward for greater freedom away from their 9-to-5 job, and they are even taking up new hobbies and interests according to this report. Thank you.